Okay, now for something completely different. I am going to talk a little bit about trying to get transgenics type approaches working in wild animals. This is what I'm going to explain to you is more about, you know, kind of what's motivating our research rather than any real results that we've achieved. But I think there's some interesting things for folks to consider working on some difficult to rear animals. So just to give you an overview of the types of questions that we're pursuing in my laboratory, we really are interested in two fundamental questions in my lab. First of all, where do novel phenotypes come from in developmental or evolutionary time? And then once you have these novel phenotypes, how do they diversify? So we've really been using electric fish to get at these questions, although we've also worked in butterflies as well to get at the question of diversification of phenotypes. Electric fish are kind of a part of a broader nexus of fishes doing weird things with their tissues, particularly muscle. So fishes have invented all sorts of interesting organs out of muscle to achieve different physiological outcomes. For instance, they've invented heater organs and sonic muscles. These are some muscles with some very odd physiological properties, the ability namely to generate heat to improve optical performance, and actually to contract their muscles so quickly that they lose some power output in order to generate sound. And then, of course, there are several lineages of fishes that can produce electric fields outside of their body. All told, there's about six lineages of electric fishes in the history of vertebrates that have evolved the ability to produce electric discharges independently from each other. That's a pretty staggering thing in vertebrates, an entire organ system has evolved that many times. Here's the phylogeny. It's fairly scattered all over the vertebrate phylogenetic tree, including some cartilaginous fishes as well as some teleosts. The primary focus in our laboratory are the Mormyrid electric fish, and for the evolution nerds out there, this is sort of at the base of the great branching event of teleost fishes. And this follows a massive whole genome duplication, so fishes have an extra set of genes. So one of the things that we've set out to sort of look at in my lab is sort of how the electric organ continues to re-evolve in vertebrates. And so one of our ideas was that perhaps electric fish have used the same sort of underlying genetic toolkit repeatedly to evolve their organs. So in order to test that hypothesis, we started by sequencing the genome of the electric eel, Electrophorus electricus, from South America. And we sequenced several lineages of the transcriptomes from several lineages of electric fishes that have evolved their electric organs independently from each other. And then we calculated expression ratios for all of the genes sort of based on the reference set of the electric eel, so we had sort of a common vocabulary to use between all those fishes. And then we evaluated using kind of a combination of literature searches to interrogate individual gene function. And what came out was this heat map, essentially, of about 30 or so genes that remarkably across several lineages of electric fish, in at the time that we published this, we looked at three independent origins, as indicated by these red bars here, of electric organs. We found several genes that showed exactly the same patterns in terms of their expression in the electric organ. We subsequently added a fourth lineage, and I can vouch for the fact that these patterns are retained for this set of genes as well. What's interesting about these genes is that they're involved in particular aspects of the electric organ that are unique to electric fish, including the maintenance of extreme excitability, the growth of very large cells as opposed to skeletal muscle, which is their developmental precursor. And also they've managed to downregulate a suite of contraction-related genes because, of course, these electric organs no longer contract, they only produce electricity. And finally, we've noted several transcription factors that seem to be early in the process of determining the fate, if you will, of muscle cells from early mesoderm that could be involved. So this was an exciting result, but even in the review process of this paper, we were getting a lot of feedback saying, okay, this is a nice list of hypotheses, but how can you go about testing those? And this is exactly where we wanted to go. So we've got this list of candidate genes that we think are somehow important in the evolution of electric organs, but what we really want to do is take that list and bring them into electric fish. So we're using things like morpholinos and CRISPRs to do knockdowns of genes that are highly upregulated in electric fish, but also to do the corollary experiment where we take genes that are in zebrafish and turn those up. So we can kind of play in two different directions, maybe make an electric Danio, if you will, and conversely make a normal fish out of a more myriid or an electric fish like that. The other half of our research program is really interested in the evolution of electric organs within the more myriid lineage. Now, this is an example of a species flock that has radiated rapidly in West Central Africa. These fishes, I can attest to, when you catch them in the field, they're all these little brown fish that are really difficult to tell apart. As it turns out, the only way to really tell them apart very well is when you put them in the recording chamber. Each one of them has a unique electrical signature associated with that. Now, that combined with several lines of evidence has suggested that potentially the evolution of electric signal diversity may be driving speciation in this lineage. So we have this link between behavioral changes and the speciation process, but what we're really interested in is what if any, are the genetic components underlying the evolution of these divergent signals. Now, what's kind of neat about these is they differ in all sorts of different ways that are sort of common to nervous system and other excitable tissue function. For instance, they differ in terms of their duration, they differ in terms of their polarity, but they also differ in terms of their complexity. So all the waveforms on the left have two bumps on them, and all the waveforms on the right have three bumps on them. And if I'm anything, I'm a bumpologist. I study the difference between two bumps and three bumps. So some of my earlier work, which I won't get into the nitty-gritty of, showed that there are anatomical changes in the organ itself that produce the difference between two-phase and three-phase waveforms. But when you map this onto the phylogeny, what we can see is that there have been there was an early origin of three-phase waveforms and multiple independent reversions back to that biphasic waveform type. And this is mirrored within this rapidly diverged species flock of which the species that we focus on is a member. More recently, we've identified a single species that's actually polymorphic for this character and forms an active hybrid zone where there are triphasic and biphasic waveforms actually meeting each other. We've just now completed sequencing the genome of these fishes, and we're using population genetics, population resequencing, to identify divergent regions associated with this signaling difference. We're pairing that together with RNA-seq data and looking for differences between these morphs to find genes that are actually involved in more the consequence of these genomic changes. And we can identify something on the order of 30 or 40 genes out of several tens of thousands of genes that are really differentially expressed between these two morphs. The ultimate goal is to use CRISPR and other transgenic technologies to, again, go from a list of genes of divergent regions in the genome toward actually knocking out or manipulating gene function in a way to test some of these hypotheses. We've started by just kind of testing the waters with doing injections, partly in collaboration with Jose Sibeli in his lab, his zebrafish group, and then now with some resources generously provided by the provost office where we can actually do these injections in the lab. What we've been able to do is we've been successful at injecting fluorescent dexatran into the fish at the single cell stage, and we've been playing with these PTOL GFPs under the control of a Xenopus elongation factor. And we're able to reliably get this unexpectedly in zebrafish and in our more myriids. We can get one egg to the 48-cell stage out of many hundreds injected. So we're still in the very early stages of getting something like this to work, but we're getting there. I'm going to skip this. Suffice it to say, we're also playing with morpholinos to affect gene function as well. We are doing an experiment where we're knocking down sodium channel function in these fishes. So we inject adults with a morpholino that blocks splicing of the sodium channel A gene, which is uniquely expressed in electrocyte tissues and nowhere else. And what we can show is that over a period of several days, we actually get a change in the amplitude of the electric signal. So effectively a proof of concept that we can take a gene, pick it, and knock it down, at least in the adult animal. And what you can see here is these blue traces back here are the amplitude of the adult normally, and then these red traces plotted on the same scalar after 3 days of morpholino treatment. So we feel like we're having a good effect on that. And this was done by an undergraduate in my lab, Sophia Sadao, and my technician, Monica Lucas. So with that, these are the folks that have helped with various aspects of this work, and please feel free to check us out on the web. Thanks. Yes?
I have a question that's unrelated to CRISPR, but
sure.
And very naive. If this has evolved in many species of fish many times independently,
yes.
Why don't we ever see electric frogs or electric other aquatic
animals? Yeah, it's a great question. I don't know the answer. I think we're very much in the early stages. I mean, one of the reasons is that electroreception is an ancestral vertebrate trait that's been lost actually in the teleost lineage and then subsequently regained. And I believe amphibians are also not electroreceptive, although now I might embarrass myself in front of this large crowd. But I think we're still trying. One of the projects, many projects in my lab, is trying to piece together, you know, what are the steps necessary to evolve an electric organ? There may be some prerequisites on the sensory side that make that useful and evolve along that trajectory, but it's a very good and open question in the field right now. David?
With Jason, for your objectives with CRISPR right here, would you be able to tackle your main questions with somatic CRISPRing, or are you trying to get things that are multi-generational?
I think, well, it's an interesting question. I mean, we're so in the early stages of just being able to inject embryos at this point and get a scorable phenotype. I think the idea would be that if we could find areas of the genome that could restrict expression of the CRISPR to the electric organ itself somehow. Is that what you're asking? Like a promoter, electric organ promoter or something
well,
like that?
Well, I could imagine how you might do that if you know or can guess what would be a good enhancer
that,
couplet to a Cas9 just
specifically why we're working with this SCN4AA gene. It's a sodium channel that we know is highly and uniquely expressed only in the electric organ. So this is a candidate for just that sort of thing. That's right.
But in this case, your experiment will be done if you can do the CRISPRing in one organism, and then at the end of its life, it's done. You're not trying to generate alleles.
That's right. That's right. That would be the phase one, and then phase two could be some sort of multi-generational type thing. But at this point, it's just looking at the effect of genes on these tissues, specifically in terms of their anatomy, but potentially their physiology as well. Yeah.
Can you speculate a little more on what you think might be driving the speciation of these forward lineages to have different electrical?
Sure. Yeah, it's a great question. In 6 minutes, it's hard to talk about it all, but I could talk for hours. I think that one of the reasons is, we have many lines of evidence. One of them is that when you look at the rate of evolution of different characters, what we can see is that electric organ rates of divergence are very high and very, very rapid versus all other characters. And then also, when you look at mate choice experiments, you can actually show that these mormyrids have a high degree of preference for specific signals that are species typical. So when you do playbacks and it's the wrong species, they won't court that electrode, basically. So there's a high degree of specificity for the appropriate signal, and that's all mediated by a very well characterized nervous system pathway that's very precise in terms of timing. So all those little bumps that I showed you earlier there are very much detectable by the fish, and we can actually measure spikes in the nervous system to prove that. So it's a combination of the neurobiology, the behavior, and also some observations from the field. It's still not fully fleshed out, but it's certainly an idea that makes it very attractive to speciation biologists, because it would be a somewhat non-conventional story if that proves to be true. Okay, thank you.